Hi, welcome to Messier Mantra. I'm your host, Mike Messier. On this episode, we have a very special guest. He's an actor and a film producer, and we're going to check out some of his work right now. So let's check out David Gere's production of Arlo the Burping Pig. We'll check that out. We'll come right back with our guest.
We're the Roses. We're new in town. I'm Alana. Of course, this is Talia. It's her first day.
Now, class, I'd like you to help me say good morning to Miss Talia. You ready? Good morning, Talia. Very nice.
Your teacher's pet.
That's Bertha. She's a bully.
First day didn't go so hot.
I think when you meet that special somebody, things are going to look a lot brighter.
And our top story from tonight, the famous Ming Dynasty vase is lifted from City Hall.
The vase? I ditched it. It's in a safe place. Don't worry. Next week. The vase in your hands. Next week.
Okay, who turned out the lights?
Feels pretty good.
I think there may be an intruder.
Inside the house?
Hey, back off!
Knockout!
I told you so.
Okay, that was the trailer for Arlo the Burping Pig, a film with one of the producers right here, my good friend, David Gere.
Thank you, sir.
And David, you worked with some good people that we both know on that film, as far as the producers, the directors. Why don't you tell me a bit about the team a little bit before we get into your life?
Sure. Arlo the Burping Pig was filmed on location in Los Angeles just about a year ago. It was a collaboration with Switzer Entertainment Group, who I produced several films with, my partner Richard Switzer, and Woodhaven Productions. Now rebranded Woodhaven Media,
right
out of East Greenwich. So Tommy DiNucci directed it, and we did all the post supervision here in Rhode Island.
I've seen Arlo the Burping Pig. I enjoyed it.
Yeah,
it was a fun movie, and you had a little cameo in there yourself.
I did have a cameo. Yeah. I played a neighborly jogger and did a bit of a stunt. I've got a background in stunts, so I try to occasionally do a stunt in a movie if it makes sense for the film. And it was a fun movie. It's a family-friendly film. It's got an adorable talking pig, an even more adorable little girl lead in Lindsay Blanchard, who's from Connecticut, so she's from out here. And the film, you know, it's out, it's released right now. It's out on home video.
And another associate of yours in another realm, pro wrestler of some note, is in the movie as a character. Who's that?
John Morrison, an incredibly famous pro wrestler who had a 10-year tenure with the WWE. He's now with Lucha Underground, which is a hot wrestling promotion that airs on the El Rey Network, directed or produced by a filmmaker, Robert Rodriguez. John had a great cameo in the movie. He played a house painter, so there was some zany stuff with John. And we're lucky to have him. You know, he lived 10 minutes away and called him up and wanted to find out if he would do a day on the film, and he did. So
it's funny how all these things come together. You're talking about pro wrestling and Robert Rodriguez with Lucha Underground. I remember reading his book, yeah. Rebel Without a Crew.
Okay.
You know, and Robert Rodriguez's book about independent filmmaking and the lengths that this guy went to reminds me of someone like you or myself, where Robert Rodriguez literally had his body tested for drugs. Like, he was a human guinea pig. Human guinea pig.
Wow.
Is how he funded El Mariachi. You know, that whole legendary, got $7,000 to make El Mariachi. Robert Rodriguez went to a human guinea pig, like, hospital or something for a month so that they could test him. Yeah. And it was just a crazy story. That book is funny, the first two chapters especially. So I think about guys like yourself who are doing, you know, in a different realm, doing wrestling, but more, most important for our nature today, the film producing and the lengths that you'll go to. And you have a really great story about Sylvester Stallone early on in your career. Tell me about some of these things that David Gere wants to be involved in films, and he's age, what, 15, 16, 17, and he does what?
My story is not unlike anyone else's when I began. I think my story became very different as I grew, as all of our stories do. But when I was younger in high school, I was the guy that had a buddy with a VHS video camera, and we shot little music videos and short films in high school. went to Providence College down the road here and took a film class on a whim, sort of for the easy A, or expecting it to be an easy class, and it was a pretty complex class.
Right.
Father Ken Gumbert still teaches this course. It's called The Catholic Imagination of Four American Filmmakers. Got really into it, pulled out of my poli-sci major, which I was pursuing, and got into film, and then took it more seriously. And fast forward some 10 years later, I got an opportunity to work with Sylvester Stallone on Rocky Balboa. Went down to Philadelphia on numerous occasions to audition for Diane Heary, who was casting the film. Didn't think I had a shot. Got a call, had to drop everything I was doing. I was working at the time in real estate. Sort of, I don't want to say I ever gave up on the dream. I never did.
Right.
But it was becoming kind of a faded, distant hope at that point.
Right.
And ended up in Rocky Balboa and worked with Stallone. And that was kind of the catalyst where I said, okay, if I can, you know, as a kid growing up watching these films, being inspired by these films, if I can end up on this set, you know, in 2008 or 2006, whenever it was shot, then I think I can make a go of it. And from there on, I really believed in it. A lot of great things started to happen for me. As an actor, I ended up in a principal role on the CW show Gossip Girl.
Yep.
I played Frank Meltzer on that show. And then, you know, the positive energy, the laws of the universe, so to speak, kind of kicked in for me. And I started producing movies after that.
A lot of stuff you've done. It's all very exciting and also motivating to people that know you because, you know, friends of ours, our friend Lori Grenier, I believe, wrote an article about you for Imagine Magazine.
Yeah.
It's a really nice article. And other people, when they get to know you, say, wow, you know, this guy is doing a lot of stuff that you don't talk about all the stuff you do sometimes, but it's like, wow, there's some fascinating stories here.
I think a lot of filmmakers tend to have a passion project that they'll dedicate a year or 2 years of their life to, and I've done that. But I also try to free up time in a day, a week, a month, in a year to get involved in other people's films where I'm contributing. So that's
right.
Why you'll see a lot of EP credits or co-producer credits for me. And the reason being is because I love this so much.
Right.
That I know I can bring something to it. I'm also, you know, gaining from the production, if I'm acting in the production or producing. And I also truly believe in extending the opportunity to my circle of peers and people that we run with, because when I started out, I didn't have that person. I didn't have someone that said, hey, Dave, if you do this, this, and this, you'll advance. I just didn't know.
Right.
You know, not to say I didn't have a couple of good mentors, but I didn't have a complete system of people around me that helped me further my career, because I think in the 90s and early 2000s, the digital age was still emerging and we didn't have the easy access. I mean, you and I have talked about this. We were mailing black and white headshots, you know,
right.
Snail mail costing you $4 or $5 to kick out one of these overnight packages, and it slows you down. You can't
right.
get to as many people. And when I realized I can help young filmmakers, young actors, young artists, young photographers, young musicians by grabbing on to, you know, whatever they're doing and saying, hey, let me help you with your project. And by the way, I think I have an opportunity for you on a bigger film than I'm producing. It really worked for me. And I think it worked for a lot of people that I've helped out.
That's great. I remember when I first started kind of working with you and just seeing what you were up to, and you invited me down to a nightclub. You ran nightclubs for
yeah,
a while.
I did.
And one was called The Reserve. It was a really cool place. And you had a film set going on, and I saw, wow, there's people from Massachusetts, people
yeah.
from Boston, drove all the way from Boston,
yeah.
you know, through Rhode Island and all the way to, you know, the Cromwell, Connecticut, Middletown, Connecticut area
yeah.
to be in this film shoot. And that was pretty wild. And then you had me on board for a music video. And also what I really enjoyed seeing was you kind of in the acting process on a short film that you acted in, Penance,
yeah.
with Maria Kanellis, and you played a priest, and that was a darker piece, but it was pretty exciting. Nick Principe directed.
That's
and,
right.
And that was right in, I believe, Warwick, Rhode Island, pretty close to where I live.
Yeah, Penance was a great project for me. Nick Principe directed and wrote the project, and he asked me to play a dark kind of priest character, which is something I'd never done, and I put a lot of time and preparation into the role, and it came out fantastic.
Nice. And but we should mention, you are Mr. Cromwell, pretty much. Mr. Middletown, Mr. Cromwell, Mr. Connecticut, as far as when I think of Connecticut Films, I'll pretty much think of you because you're the guy that's kind of getting things going in the state of Connecticut. And from what I understand, they are pretty film friendly, but in kind of this, you know, area, you're kind of doing a lot of good things in Connecticut. Tell us about that.
Connecticut had a really strong film making movement in the early 90s with Amistad. True Lies was shot down there. And then it reemerged in the early 2000s, and then it flattened out. The tax credit, unfortunately, was gone. And I started to say to myself, well, if we can, you know, resurrect it with bringing these Hollywood productions here. So I produced Blue Line, Pitching Tents, House Rules, and some on-location stuff from a film called Black Wake in Connecticut all in the last 2 years.
Nice. One of the films that you worked with some good people, I got to visit the set, was Christmas All Over Again. And I believe the lady's Christy Romano.
Yep.
And tell me about Christmas All Over Again.
I forgot that one, yeah. So Christmas All Over Again was filmed in Connecticut. I produced it just over a year ago. Actually, exactly a year ago.
Yeah.
Christy Romano from Even Stevens fame and Kim Possible fame, and I are good friends, and she grew up in Milford, Connecticut, and we had a meeting, and she had said her sort of dream was to produce a Christmas film in Milford, and I put a deal together with Richard Switzer of Switzer Entertainment, and we got a film off the ground really quickly and shot it in March of last year.
Let's take a look at Christmas All Over Again, the trailer, so people can see what we're talking about. We'll come back and talk more about it. Christmas All Over Again, filmed in Connecticut.
Yeah.
Yourself, Richard Switzer, we should mention, he's a cool guy too. I mean, he's got a lot of stuff going on. You guys have worked pretty well together.
Yeah, we've been working together for about 3 years. He's out in LA, and we partner up on a film, a couple films a year.
Yeah. Yeah, and his story, he'll have to come out here sometime, because he's got a whole life story. Young guy who just got into it, but he's really doing well. And Sean Ryan Fox, one of the lead actors in this thing.
Yeah,
I got to talk with him. He's a cool kid. You know, he's what, 16 something years old, 17.
And he's one of the leads of the Nickelodeon show Henry Danger.
Yes.
And Christy felt strongly about putting him in the film. Did a fantastic job. We had Joey Lawrence, who people from our generation would, of course, you know, remember.
Whoa. Yeah.
No better than Sean. But what's great about the film is you've got a strong director in Christy Romano who really understands these feel-good family festive films. She's a TV star in her own right. Then you've got Sean as a current star on television. Joey, you know, Joey's an iconic
legend,
TV actor.
Give me a break.
So, yeah, we're lucky to have that cast. And it just had a good feeling about it. And it was tough. We, you know, some of the things that you don't realize in watching it, we filmed in all throughout March and early April. And we, you know, we had weather like we have here now.
Right.
You know, rain, drizzle, not much snow. So, you know, those are the challenges of making a film like that. But, you know, we pulled it off. And and again, the film was edited here in Rhode Island with Woodhaven.
Well, I think Sam Eilertsen and Tommy DiNucci, I believe.
Tom and Sam on the post-production on that film, yeah.
Yeah. And what I liked about Christie's involvement was that she was acting, but also kind of like moving the ship along at times too.
Sure.
Like she was wearing this very elegant wedding dress, and I'm sitting there kind of, you know, just watching, but she's like calling the shots as she's acting. Yeah. And I'm like, because she's so passionate.
Well, we should mention that you have a cool role in the film too, and then you were in the wedding sequences where Christy did in fact wear a wedding gown, which was funny to watch her act in this, you know, very intricate, ornate gown and then direct and do all the things off camera. So yeah, she did a great job.
Yeah, and that's challenging. So I've got like three major questions for you.
Sure.
But first of all, Messier Mantra. What is a mantra of David Gere, film producer?
I think in terms of being a film producer and having the journey that I had in this business, it's pretty simple for me. It's self-belief. I always thought if you truly, at the end of your day, sit in bed and stare up at that ceiling and think, I can do this. I can start tomorrow again and take a step. That's what I've always applied to my life, regardless of what I do personally, with regard to my career, especially with film and entertainment, because it's a it's a brutally tough business, as you know.
Yep.
There's a lot of ups and downs. There's a lot of, hey, I finally got this role, or I'm producing this movie, and then it's over, and you have to wait for the next one.
Or it doesn't even happen.
Exactly. Right. That's a good point. There's a lot of projects that fall apart due to financing or creative differences.
Schedules
or the star pulled out. So for me, it's blind optimism. I believe that I'm going to continue my journey and live my dream, and I have.
Right.
But there was a lot of times when the chips were down, and I had to just sort of have that moment where I felt like, okay, I know this is going to happen. We're going to start again tomorrow. I'm going to make that extra phone call, take that extra step, work on this business proposal, which is a lot of what producers do, hit up this guy that has a financing lead, leverage my own business contacts to procure something for the film that we need. And it's I think it's just that idea that, you know, I'm gonna make it happen. It may take a couple of steps extra, but I've always applied that to my life.
That's good, because it is tough, you know, and sometimes you hit, myself, everybody, you hit that mental, emotional anguish.
Right.
And even the crazy thing, David, sometimes when you're doing well, when I'm doing well, and things are actually happening, well, why isn't this doing better?
Yeah.
You know, I've got this, you know, regional award or something, this movie got made. How come it's not? You know, and maybe that's good because you're competing with yourself and some vision of your own career as far as I want to accomplish this much or have, you know, this film come together. So maybe that's good in a sense, but it can also drive you nuts too.
Yeah, I think perseverance, mental toughness is very important in this business. Because there are days where you're not working, quite frankly.
Right.
In terms of the traditional sense of being on a set and generating work, but the good filmmaker, the good actor, is always working on themselves and their craft. And for me, it's that drive to see the finish line. And the steps are so critical. A lot of people will look beyond tomorrow and look at the finish line. I see the finish line mentally and imagine me being there and what I need to do to be there, but I'm more focused on tomorrow's work, because you have to figure out a way to get there. And some people get impatient,
right?
Or they feel they deserve a bit more now.
Right.
I've never felt that way. I'm grateful to be acting. I'm grateful to be producing movies. Also, my dream was to be an extra on a movie set. I wanted to just walk on one movie set and say, hey, Mom, look, I'm in this movie. And then I felt stronger about the art form and I learned more about the business side of it. And I started to focus on the tiny details that lead to the opportunities. I'm not one of these guys that thinks, you know, someone's going to call me up and change my life. It's never happened for me, and I don't believe that. I've had amazing things happen to me, but it was preparation,
right,
and being situated emotionally, mentally, and with my toolkit to be ready for that opportunity or to create it. And that's just what's worked for me.
What do people do that are watching this that want to, and this could probably be a 10-hour seminar, what can people do that are watching this to take an action step for themselves?
And with regard to the entertainment industry?
Yeah, wants to be a screenwriter or an actor, and I know that, like I said, it could be a 10-hour seminar, but maybe there's a book you could recommend, or a website, or just a philosophy or a course of action. Like I said, it's a 10-hour seminar, but do you have any little nugget that someone watching this could take that?
What I did, and I still do, is I watch a lot of movies.
Right.
Because if you don't truly love the art form and understand what's happening in film and entertainment now, you might be behind the curve. I'm always surprised at how many filmmakers don't watch film.
Right.
Because if I wanted to play basketball or I wanted to be in the NBA, I would imagine that I've turned on, you know, TNT and watched, Michael Jordan, you know, blow through defenders and dunk on somebody at one point in my life. So for me, it's being a student of the game,
right?
Understanding what's been done, understanding what's out now, what's, you know, in terms of context, what your ideas and your creative vision could be relatable to the marketplace, and then freeing up that alone time, and whether if you're working at, you know, a day job or what you might think is a dead end job, or even if you're an attorney or a doctor and you have this desire to get into some aspect of your creative world, to free up that time, because you can only talk about it so much.
Right.
And you and I get pitched all the time.
Yes.
And the first thing I say to people is, well, have you written anything? Or have you taken those headshots if you want to be an actor? So freeing up the time to take the steps. And for an actor, it's a headshot.
Right.
And for a screenwriter, it's a treatment or a first draft.
Or a script. And
you have to do
a script.
The work. Yeah. You absolutely have to do the work. And if you don't, you're you know, obviously not in a position to take the next step. And the final thing for me is just to, you know, it's an incredible time for young people that want to be in the entertainment business. You can get on Facebook and find guys like us who are doing it professionally, and you can contact them and say, hey, look, I watched your movie, or Mike, I read your script online, or I heard you won that award. Do you mind if I fire off my stuff to you?
Right.
Guys like us are typically, in a position to help, and also are nice enough to help. I always respond, and I always help. And so those are the tools I think that would start someone off if they were interested in beginning a career now.
Nice. And it's funny because you mentioned that. And just the other night, I had a friend, or not even a friend, a guy that I knew through in a situation, asked me what I was doing. And I said screenwriting. He said, well, how do you write a screenplay? And I was like, we're literally about to go on stage for a play, and I'm like, you gotta get final draft screenwriting.
Sure.
Rather than say, oh, okay, I've heard about it. You guys started arguing with me about the difference between final draft and Celtic screenwriting. I said, we're about to go live on stage here, man. I can't have an argument about what screenplay is better, you know, software is better.
Right.
We've got about 5 minutes. Take that time to talk about next projects. You've got a couple in the works.
I'm going into pre-production with Tom DiNucci again at Woodhaven Media, my partner there. For another Christmas movie, it's called The Santa Files. We're packaging that film, getting people involved, and it's about to get greenlit for the end of March.
Nice.
So we're doing all this all over again, from what you saw in the clip there. It's a similar film, kids adventure film,
with
a whimsical kind of magical storyline and ending.
Right.
I have the film House Rules in post production. Which I produced in Connecticut last year. It's an underground MMA fight film.
Right.
It comes out this summer from Octane Entertainment. I have the coming of age film, Pitching Tents, to be released at the end of this month from Emerging Entertainment, and in development on a lot of projects. One with you, Fighter to Play Basketball. Also a project called Day for Night, which is a thriller heist film with a really unique twist that I'm doing with Chelsea Vail in Connecticut, hopefully by May. So it's a constant workflow and constant collaboration and working with the teams and partners that I've had success with.
Nice. Now, if people wanted to look you up, how would you recommend that they do IMDb Pro something to that extent?
IMDb Pro for my contact information, and then. Look, I'm pretty accessible on social media.
Right.
I'm on Twitter, it's just David_Gere, Facebook, David Gere. And, if people message me, I get back to them.
Yes, I've noticed that. That's good. And some of the guys that you've brought into the mix, so to speak, around here that I've had the pleasure, and thank you for being able to work with you, and also some of the people that you are connected with and have earned those relationships, like a Kevin Nash. And who would have guessed, like even 5 years ago, 3 years ago, that I'd be standing there doing a little scene, in Anders Manor with Kevin Nash, Big Daddy Cool. But I remember when you found out that he had agreed to be in one of your projects, Blue Line, and how excited you were.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what it is, because I think about things like this, and it's like, it's ultimately, someone's making a film, and they want celebrity X to be in it. Like this actor, this actress, like, hey, I like Kevin Nash's work. I think he's a great personality. And then that was basically you. And then poof. Not just poof, but a lot of hard work. But for the outsiders, it's a poof. Here he is, and all of a sudden we're working with Kevin Nash in 3 or 4 films, and he's a great guy.
Kevin has become a dear friend, and I, despite being very involved in pro wrestling, which I am, and having cast a lot of pro wrestlers, I had never had access to Kevin Nash.
Right.
I quickly met him at a signing. Kevin's in his own category because not only is he a legend of pro wrestling, he's considered on the A-level in the acting world because he's been in The Punisher, the Magic Mike films, Longest Yard, so on and so forth. So Kevin has a bankability and a sales value attached to him, which is based off of box office. So I contacted his agent.
He
said, hey, here's who I am. I want to make an offer for Kevin Nash and Blue Line.
Right.
And the guy got, his agent got right back to me, and we had him on set in a couple weeks.
And he was really cool to work with. And you've had other really cool guys. You've worked with Diamond Dallas Page. I mean, there's so many things we don't have time to talk. Diamond Dallas Page, Vincent Pastore, some of the guys in House Rules. I mean, just a lot of cool individuals that you've brought into the mix. Tommy Dreamer, of course. I mean, he's great.
I appreciate that. And I think it's the type of thing where I've been blessed to have a work history and a resume that you have to point to when you go out to these the representation for these guys. And people say, okay, this guy makes movies, you know, and you know, you have to make the appropriate pitch. And I've been fortunate to have had a long list of celebrity and name performers that have done a great job in my projects.
Well, that's very cool. David Gere, we're going to have you on another episode.
Thank you.
But if there's anything, you have 30 seconds to say goodbye to the Messier Mantra audience this time.
Mike, I appreciate you having me on, and hopefully I dropped a little bit of knowledge and a bit about my story for anybody out there listening that's interested in pursuing a dream. That's what I did, and it's worked out pretty well, and I'm humbled to talk about it.
Well, David Gere, thank you for coming on Messier Mantra.
You.
Thanks for watching this episode of Messier Mantra with film producer David Gere. We'll bring back David for another episode. Until next time, we'll see you right here on Messier Mantra.